Thank you so much. A very good morning to all of you. And I would like to talk more about the POXO cases, because whosoever is working in the field of forensics, DNA typing and investigation of crime cases, they'll understand that POXO cases are highly important cases as far as crime investigation is concerned. So if you talk of DNA profiling in case of sexual assault cases, volumes of information are available about what biological evidence has to be looked into, and how it has to be collected and how it has to be preserved. And as far as the DNA technology is concerned, the technology is more or less universal across the globe and is also considered as the gold standard in case of identification. However, when practically dealing the cases, the real problems, they creep up, and it's really necessary to understand those problems. So I'll discuss some cases, and based on those cases, we'll try to discuss the problems which arise in such cases and how they should be mitigated. So in 2012, there was one case where a teenage girl, she was abducted and she went missing. And after 2 months, the police, they get an intelligence that she was last seen with two boys. When interrogated, the two boys confessed to sexual assault and murder of the girl. And they revealed that they murdered the girl and buried her in a cow shed. So upon exhumation, an autopsy, it was found that the victim was pregnant and the fetus was sent for DNA profiling. Now, as far as the investigator is concerned, as far as the DNA expert is concerned, the first idea will come is, okay, the idea of ascertaining the paternity will be the first idea. And they'll think, okay, if you ascertain the paternity of the fetus, most of the case will be solved as far as the DNA evidence is concerned. But now what the reality is, the fetus was preserved in formaldehyde. And DNA profiling witnessed no success despite lot of R&D which we put into the entire process. And thus, it would have been a very simple case of simply a paternity testing turned out to be a fruitless effort when the sample was wrongly preserved. In the second case, this case is of 2017, a teenage girl, she was reported to be pregnant, and she accused her father and cousin brother of sexually assaulting her. And she was given some abortifacient by her family. The medical officer was able to collect only some remnants of the product of conception. So the product of conception which was received in this case, well, there was 20 small pieces, 20 small fragments, which were morphologically, they could not be indistinguishable. They were indistinguishable. And one would normally assume that the sample should be homogeneous and may, under pressure to quickly dispose of the case, may go for random sampling. And accordingly, so which is the normal approach is, we randomly selected 3 pieces of this tissue and we did the DNA profiling. And what we found was, these are the profiles that came out. The profile was exactly identical to the DNA profile of the victim. So the product of conception and the victim, they had the same profile. That simply means that the product of conception which was collected, it was of the uterine origin. It was not of the fetal origin. So hence, we subjected all the 20, more than 20 pieces for DNA profiling. And most interestingly, out of that 20 pieces, one piece gave a mixed profile, which was of maternal origin as well as fetal contribution. And finally, one piece gave a profile, clean profile, which was entirely of fetal origin. And the paternity of the product of conception could be fixed with the father of the victim. So basically, the report, if you just follow a random method by giving a report by on random sampling, you may end up with a wrong result. And this will be not in the interest of justice, nor in the interest of science. So one need to understand that the conventional sampling may not always work. Random samplings may not work in case of forensic samples. So you need to own your sampling according to the samples which you receive. So finally, when we got the profile, so we had a profile from the product of conception and the accused, and the father of the, who was the father of the victim, and a set of alleles could be assigned to that, to the father, and paternity testing could also be performed statistically. So this is another case which I would like to discuss. This is a very famous case in which a teenage school girl, she was found raped and murdered in a forest area. The body was naked with various stages of maggots growth on them that indicated a lapse of time. A bite mark was conspicuous on the left breast of the victim. Ideally, the bite mark area should have been swabbed and submitted for DNA profiling. However, in this case, the bite mark was swabbed and the swab was dabbed onto an FDA card. And due to the lapse of time, the evidence was already degraded and further diluted as it was spread onto a large surface area of an FDA card. So this is the FDA card which was received. So you can see the evidence, which was already a very dilute evidence, it should have been collected onto a swab. That swab should have been dried and sent for DNA profiling. But instead, it was collected onto a large cotton ball, and that ball was dabbed onto an FTA card. And what happened is, like, the minute amount of evidence, which was already highly degraded, that was spread onto a large surface of a FTA card. So normally one would assume, okay, if you use a 1.2 mm punch, a Harris punch, 1.2 mm sample from the FDA card and put it for DNA profiling, which is the conventional approach. So whereas this was a degraded sample, they should have a contribution of female also. So instead of using a conventional method, what we did, which actually didn't witness any success when we tried, so instead we collected a 1.1 centimeter cutting from the FDA card, and that was extracted with the conventional method. And when we conducted the DNA profiling, we got a profile which was essentially a mixed profile, in which, however, the male contribution to this profile was very much apparent, and female component was also visible and was slightly higher as compared to the male component. But yes, a clean profile, contribution of the male was definitely visible in this case. And further, YSTR DNA profiling also revealed that the contribution was likely from one person, because we got only one profile hinted towards a single involvement of a single place, single person. And in that vicinity of that crime crime scene, an empty country liquor bottle was also found, along with the cut plastic bottle which was used to make a sort of a cup from that bottle. And the swab, the rim of the bottle and the rim of the cut bottle was both were swabbed, and we conducted the DNA profiling from that. And here one has to be very careful that there was history of lapse of time, and it was rainy season. So it was necessary to take utmost care while sampling. So negative controls and reagent blanks, they need to be run for each and every item which is subject to DNA profiling, even including the cotton swabs which you use, the gloves which you use, the plastic ware which you use, in addition to the reagents, so as to ensure that no extraneous or contaminant DNA enters the process. Because in case of a blind rape and murder case, if any extraneous DNA enters, it will lead to very, very wrong results. And instead of getting the profile of the perpetrator, you'll be getting profile of someone else. That will totally derail the investigation. So we got clean autosomal STR DNA profiles from the bottles. And similarly, a clean autosomal profile was also available from the bottle, and similarly a partial DNA profile was obtained from the dupatta of the victim, but it was consistent with the DNA profile which was obtained from the bottles, as well as the mixed profile which was obtained from the bite mark on the breast of the victim. So this indicated there was only one person which was involved in this case. And the vaginal swabs of the victim, they didn't yield desirable results because of maggot infestation of the private part. And the case had been portrayed as a gang rape by the media and by the people, but the DNA profiling indicated otherwise. And accused was apprehended after screening of large number of people through YSTR DNA profiling, also to narrow down upon a group of people. And sampling and profiling in such cases can be a tricky issue, and sampling and isolation method should be accordingly adjusted. So in another sexual assault case, in which it was again a POXCO case, in 2015, a teenage girl was sexually assaulted in a hotel room. The incident was reported by her after 2 weeks. Hence, possibility of DNA profiling from the vaginal swabs was almost negligible. It was ruled out. The only evidence which was available was a bed sheet which was collected from the hotel room, and it was sent for testing. Now, in our institution, we have a DNA division and biology division separately. So biological examination established the presence of semen on the bed sheet, and according to the bed sheet, it was submitted to the DNA division for DNA profiling. The semen may belong to accused or other males who occupied the room after the accused. So which is a condition, the bed, because normally it's a condition in a low budget hotel, the bed sheet may not be changed for days. So now in this case, there may be n number of contributors of semen or DNA onto the bed sheet. The record of occupancy may help to find a logical value of n. And similarly, DNA contribution for females is also there. So this is a dicey issue over there. So for a biological examination, when we did the DNA profiling, as far as the biological examination, because the detection of semen ends the process. Okay, you detected semen. Now, when we did the DNA profiling, what we found was the profile which came out of the stain, which was identified by during biological examination, that profile didn't match with the accused. So Now this means there is no evidence, DNA evidence available from the for that event. So then this takes you back against to the n number of possibilities which we discussed previously. There might be n number of people who occupied that room and used that bedsheet. So giving a negative opinion based on a single stain sounded unjustifiable. So instead, more stains were looked for, and we found some 8 inconspicuous stains which were not very conspicuous, and we subjected all of them to DNA profiling. And out of them, more than profiles from more than 5 males were obtained. And from an inconspicuous stain, we found a profile which was a mixed profile and was having components from both the accused as well as the victim. So ultimately, we were able to fix the case based on DNA profiling. So this is the profile which you got. It's a mixed profile. You can see this it's a contribution of male and a female. At each loci, you can see. This case clearly indicates that all the logical possibilities need to be kept in mind while conducting DNA profiling in case of sexual assault cases. And DNA analysis is not about disposing of a case, it's about reaching a conclusion that is just. Though it takes time, but the effort does win the reward of taking the case to a logical conclusion. And further, the n number of possibilities, they don't haunt the expert in coming future. Because if you leave these possibilities, those possibilities will haunt you in the future. So in another case, in certain times, what happens in case of sexual assault cases, the version which is given by the victim, it may not be a correct version. It may be wrong or influenced version. So a 9-year girl filed a complaint to her mother that she had been sexually assaulted. This is a case of 2009. So POCSO law was not enacted at that time, but the case is very similar. So biological examination revealed the presence of semen on the vaginal swabs and slides of the victim. DNA profiling technology was not available with that at that time. So again, the case was submitted for DNA profiling in 2010. And when we conducted the DNA profiling, the DNA profiles which were obtained from the swabs of the victim, they didn't match with the DNA profile of the accused. The family of the victim was not satisfied with the DNA report, and they blocked traffic and sat on dharna. They filed RTIs to know whether the test could be conducted afresh and can they witness it, or can it be conducted in some other lab. So we were very clear in that. We said that the DNA profiles can be conducted by any CFSL or FSL which has the DNA profiling facility, and witnessing the test may not be possible because it's not like a color test and a layman may not be able to comprehend it. And the family of the victim was still not convinced. They moved the High Court of Himachal Pradesh, and accordingly the High Court of Himachal Pradesh ordered a CBI probe into the rape and murder case. And the victim, because the victim has claimed that she felt that DNA report was not satisfactory, it was wrong, and the main accusation was that police had changed the blood sample. So that's why the DNA report was, but ultimately the onus was coming on the DNA expert also. And as for my experience, it was the first DNA profiling case in a sexual assault which I had conducted, so this was also really a testing time for me. So the victim alleged that the police had not nabbed the accused. The police failed to arrest the accused because the DNA test report was negative. The High Court issued notices to the police officer dealing the case. The High Court also ordered a CBI probe into the case, and the exhibits of the victim, swabs, slides, etc., were sent to DNA testing to CBI lab. This time, the blood sample of the accused, it was documented through videograph. The collection of the blood sample of the accused was done through video. It was documented through videography. The result of the DNA test from CBI came after 2 months. The findings of the DNA test for CBI was the same as that of state FSL, and the DNA of the accused didn't match with the DNA which was found on the swabs of the victim. So DNA report that was issued by us, it was in 2010. The report of CBI came in 2012. The entire period in between becomes the testing time for the expert. So as per the unofficial inputs, the families of the victim and the accused in this case, they were not in good terms. And for 5 days, the victim, she didn't identify anybody. She didn't identify. The fifth day, after mentoring by mentoring to her parents or family, she started naming the neighbor. And the real accused has still not been traced. The DNA profile is with us. We have another profile from a similar case where the modus operandi was similar. And the same profile we received in the same case, because our country lacks a DNA database. So once we have a DNA database, criminal DNA database, there's a possibility that someday we'll be able to crack the case and identify the real perpetrator of that case. This case highlights that evidence should be consumed, not consumed fully during DNA testing, because DNA testing is basically a destructive technique. If a fraction of evidence is saved during analysis, It will help you to verify your results later on should any questions arise. So the expert may come under tremendous pressure in such cases where the reports are questioned, and one learns to handle this with time. And this case highlights the evidence should not be consumed fully during testing, and some portion or some part of the evidence should be retained for future testing. And this will be in the interest of justice and the interest of expertise also. And use of checks and controls at every step will ensure reliability of results and give confidence to the expert. It is not uncommon that victim and her family may turn hostile during trial. This is another sort of cases also, with the victim and her family may turn hostile during trial. So in such a scenario, a positive DNA report with respect to identity of the perpetrator or the accused is of immense value. The importance of a positive DNA report in the event of victim turning hostile has been appreciated and relied upon by honorable courts. In Criminal Appeal 620/2015 of the Honorable High Court of Himachal Pradesh appreciated the value of scientific evidence despite the victim turning hostile. In this case, the positive DNA report stands corroborated with other circumstances, so the DNA report and other corroborative circumstances are sufficient to convict the accused. This is the observation of the High Court. In this event, when the victim turns hostile, the prosecution relies a lot on the DNA evidence. And DNA can be decisive in the outcome of a trial in such cases. So likewise, sometimes the conventional technology which is available with you may also fail in delivering the results. So accordingly, you have to adjust, and with the new technology also adopt new technology also. So till now, we had only the capillary electrophoresis, which is the scenario for vast majority of the country. But now is the time to introduce NGS also. We got one case where we got an FTA card, which was supposed to be three FTA cards of mother, father, and a fetus. So accidentally, the blood sample from the placenta of the fetus was collected. And this DNA, when we did the DNA profiling through CE, we found that the profile was predominantly of that of the mother. So it was not the representative blood sample of the child, but it was more of blood sample of the mother. And when we did the conventional STR based CE method, so we were getting only the profile of the mother, except one allele, which was supposedly which was the obligate allele of the father. But with the single allele, it's not possible to reach a conclusion. Because the fetus was a female, the possibility of typing via STRs was also not possible. So we went in for NGS, and when we did the NGS profiling, so what is the good thing about NGS is it can cover large number of markers simultaneously. And because the technology is based on DNA synthesis of the DNA, and it can also detect isoalleles, because based on the sequencing, not on the fragment length. So here in this slide, if you see the circle in the center, red color circle in the center, you can see you have A and G visible for 13 allele. So normally, if you have that allele in one person, CE will read it as one allele. Whereas if you do it through NGS, it means there are two alleles available, because the internal sequence of that allele, the repetition region, is different as compared to the other allele. So this is one good thing about NGS. And based on our testing, you are able to detect about 10 obligate autosomal STRs of the father in the sample, one XSTRs, and 11 identity SNPs. And this would have been not possible with the CE. So it's also necessary that we adapt the newer and latest technology. So now coming to the stark reality of what happens as far as the sample collection and preservation is concerned. So if we look at sample collection and preservation, you'll see this is the real scenario. So in this case, you see a vaginal swab in which a cotton gauze has been used to prepare a vaginal swab. And here, similarly, in the next slide, you can see a wooden piece has cotton wrapped on a wooden piece has been used to prepare a vaginal swab. Now the question arises over here is the cotton or cotton gauze which has been used over here, who will certify that it was free of extraneous DNA? And moreover, this method also seems to be quite crude and quite inhumane. Further, many times the clothes of the victim, they are collected, or the accused, they are collected and packed in polythene and sent, and by the time they reach the lab, you have huge amount of fungal and bacterial growth on that, and you get plenty of DNA out of it, but it's not the DNA the victim or the accused is the DNA of the fungus or fungus or bacteria which is coming out. And similarly, this is one another problem which we witnessed is that many a times, because what is the medical officer doing? They are collecting the sample from the they are collecting the vaginal swabs, and those swabs, they are spreading it a smear. They're preparing a smear of that onto a slide, and they're discarding the swab. The swab is the ideal sample for DNA profiling, not the slide. Slide is basically for microscopy, and there is possibility of the slide getting contaminated during staining or other processes and leading to erroneous results. So many times we have witnessed that the swab is discarded by the medical officer and only the slide is sent for DNA profiling, and that becomes a really, really dicey and tricky issue. Now, even if you have good technologies at your disposal, now in this case, a blood sample and a fetus has been collected for DNA profiling. The femur of a fetus has been collected for DNA profiling, and they have been packed in a polythene together. So though FTA is one of the latest technology available for sampling, but since it has been packed with the wet bone sample, it will have a bearing on the results and testing. Similarly, an FTA card which has been packed in a leukoplast. So once you try to open the leukoplast, the FTA cards also gets torn into bits and pieces, and again there will be difficult while presenting in the court because your FTA is already into pieces. Another problem which we witnessed was FTA card which you are witnessing on the left side, there's the right amount of blood sample has been put. One drop of blood has been put onto FTA card. A punch is the amount, 1.2 mm punch is the size which is required to get a DNA profile. But I know somehow a wrong notion prevailed in the medical fraternity that the entire circle has to be filled up with blood. And in that process, they overload the card with excess of blood. And what happens is when you try to purify these FTA cards with the conventional FTA purification buffer, they don't turn white because this heme content has to be removed for DNA profiling. And the main reason over here is using FTA card is to quickly get a DNA profile so that you cut short DNA extraction process also. But what happens is when you have FTA cards which don't get fully clarified of the red content, the heme content, there'll be PCR failures. And specifically with the older kits like the Y filer, the failures were very, very frequent. So with a conventional buffer, even if you keep the FTA card in conventional buffer, washing it for 48 hours, it would remain reddish in color. And so to take care of that, we developed an in-house protocol by which you can purify a FTA card in 5 to 10 minutes. Even if it's highly overloaded containing a lot of blood sample, then also you can purify it in 5 to 10 minutes, and accordingly you can get a DNA profile. We published that in an international journal. It's a new protocol for purification of FTA cards, and based on this method we were able to conduct DNA profiling in a case of paternity in 4 hours. So the person comes with the samples in the morning and by afternoon he leaves with the report. So within 4 hours also we was able to fix a paternity case. So this was possible with this protocol. And similarly, many times what happens is like the exhibits, they are packed in papers. Now people are starting saying that pack the samples in paper. Now suppose if you have samples which require refrigeration, and if they are packed in paper and if you put them in a refrigerator, in India power supply is not guaranteed. You have fluctuations. There'll be formation of frost. There'll be freeze and thaw. And ultimately when you take out the parcels, pieces of the parcels will be falling off. The covering of the parcel will be falling, then that will have bearing on the chain of custody of the samples when you present those parcels in the court. So the conventional cloth method is much, much better compared to the paper method. And similarly, we stress other problems also in case blind cases of rape and murder. The samples of the victim which pertain to sexual assault, they are packed along with the viscera. And as far as viscera collection is concerned, we are still living in 1960s and 1950s. Large jars are used for collection and preservation of samples, and many of these, the contents of these jars, they might spill off and fall onto the samples which are meant for DNA profiling, and ultimately hamper the entire process or spoil the entire process. And this is another important thing. Many times old cases, they also come up for DNA profiling, because there might be cases which may be a decade old or more than that when DNA profiling was not conducted. Only semen presence of semen was established during biological examination, and DNA profiling was not conducted. So when the courts desire, the DNA profiling should also be conducted. So these samples, they may be lying in a malkhana of a police or some other place. So what happens is, by the time they come up for DNA profiling, they'll be infested with termites. And when you have termites growing on all these things, so your samples are destroyed to a large extent. And now if you think of running something like the Innocence Project, in which is being run in USA, where 20 years, 30 years, 15 years old DNA samples are being subjected to DNA profiling, re-subjected to DNA profiling to find out the real truth. Do you think that thing will be possible in India? Will it be possible to run something akin to the Innocence Project in India with such type of sample preservation? So not just sample preservation from hospital or from crime scene till lab, but beyond that should also be thought of. Even after the trial also should be thought of. And these things need to be taken care of. So though we say that the safe kits which have come up now, they may solve problems to a large extent, but still the way you use the things, it depends a lot. So if a FDA card is used in the wrong way, if the swab is not preserved properly, that there will be problems in that. So what is required is lot of training has to go into entire this thing, and there has to be plenty of interaction between the DNA experts as well as police, as well as the medical fraternity. So what would we take away from this thing is that it is of utmost importance that proper identification, collection, preservation of biological evidence is done. In the lab, proper storage and segregation of exhibits is must. Selection of right approach and method for DNA isolation is must. It should be honed as per the sample which you are getting. Process evidence and reference samples separately to check cross-contamination. DNA isolation should be separated by time and space to nullify chances of cross-contamination. All the possibilities should be taken care of while planning and executing DNA analysis for a crime case. There should not, there should be a need to develop in-house methods, and these methods should be validated prior to use. Sampling at lab level is a vital process, and it should be based on the type of case sample which is available. Running of controls and reagents blank should be integral part of the process, and this guard should never be lowered while dealing sexual assault cases. There should be intermediate checks in the entire process. There should be frequent interaction with the medical officers as so that they understand what is the requirement with respect to DNA profiling, as the control of oversampling is resting with them. Use of probabilistic stats has to be made part of the reporting, and likewise population data has to be generated. And use of the new technologies like NGS, MPS should be introduced, as they have more testing options available in a single go. And DNA database of criminals is must, and at the moment, and possibilities of having local databases at lab level or at state level should also be explored. So thank you so much for patiently listening.